Hello everyone, how's it going? I am the Average Guy 1983. Thank you very much for tuning into my channel today. In today's video, I'm going to be talking to you guys about my experience with my JL Audio C7 system that I put into my 2019 Ford Flex. This system that I put into my Flex consists of 12 JL Audio C7 speakers, 3 HD600/4 amplifiers for those 12 speakers, an HD750/1 for a 10W6 V3, and a Ford Flex Stealth Box intended for a 10W3 V3 that I put in the 10W6 into. Other things I have in this system that are not JL Audio are the Audio Control LC7i, which is picking up all the radio signals from the stock head unit over to the LC7, and from the LC7 going out to the DSPs, and from the DSPs finally going out to the amplifier. So it's like a big chain. I also have an Audio Control Epicenter that helps me here and there to enhance some of the bass that just doesn't sound that low frequency enough to be able to get like a good sound to come out of the sub. And I like to talk to you guys about all of that. So this video is going to be a little bit long. So as long as you guys are patient with me, I can get into all of this in detail and give you guys my experience on all of this and what's good about it, what's bad about it, and what changes I would make or would have made if I had the opportunity to go back in time and try to make any adjustments. So let's get to the video. Alrighty, so before we get started on all of this gear, I'd like to first let you guys know to please use my video only as a guide if you plan on putting a system together for your own vehicle. I'm just a regular DIY person. I am not in any way or have I ever considered myself a professional car audio installer, professional car audio fabricator, or even a professional car audio programmer or tuner when it comes to DSPs. So as long as you guys take that, you know, into consideration, we can continue on with the video. So this way, in case anybody comes up and starts saying some negative things in the comments, I want you guys to understand that I am not considering myself a professional in any way. Alrighty everyone, so I am outside and there is a lot of road noise, so please excuse any background noise that you hear. I'm going to try to keep this as quick as possible. One of the reasons why I went with the LC7i instead of going with like a Fix 86 or even a DM608 by Audio Control was because I already had an LC6i that I was using. Unfortunately, I dislocated one of the inputs on this side because I had these wires too tight, so it actually pulled out of its little socket and I was able to put it back. It turns out it wasn't soldered off, it was just a little connector that got dislocated, but it stayed permanent. So when you put these together, make sure that you give yourself enough wiggle room on these wires so that it won't be pulling these connectors down and dislocate them by accident, because everything on the Audio Control LC7 or LC6 have really flimsy style RCA connectors, and that's kind of a bad thing about them, but they work overall. Other than that, I was able to get a maximum of 4.3 volts out of this one. So you can kind of see right here, it's almost at max because I have it exactly at 4 volts. This one for the rear door only does 3.8 volts coming out of this. So I maxed it out to that 3.8 volts. I can't go any higher than that. It's completely maxed out. And I'm assuming that it's because of the rear fill deal on most car audio systems for stock radios. So this one here has also 4 volts at 40 Hertz. And I was able to go up to a maximum of like 5.8. So it's exactly at 4 volts. I can go, like you see here, I can go all the way down to where almost the letter L is right there. But I have it right at this edge at 4 volts even. The Accubase is basically a fancy word for bass boost. It activates with voltage depending where you have it set up after you turn up your music. If that voltage is met, regardless to a low frequency tone, so let's say somebody plays a song with a bass kick starting and it's really loud, or a bass strum on a bass guitar and it plays loud, and that voltage is met, it's going to immediately activate the Accubase from 0 to 100 as to wherever you have this program, similar to having a gain set on an amplifier using a bass knob. When you hear that, it does sound good, but you know, with most music, but when you play bass heavy music, like let's say music like from 50 Cent, Busta Rhymes, Ice Cube, Snoop Dogg, or even Syfe Morrison, or any other artists like that, that play bass heavy music, your subwoofer is going to sound too powerful and overdriven. Then you're going to have to come down here to your seat and manually put this back to where you originally have it so that your subwoofer won't sound overwhelmed or overpowered. I do recommend that you leave this in the center and set your gains on your amplifiers to where they have to be. And then once you start playing music, then adjust this, because this will be kind of considered like your overlap in a way from my experience, and we'll be able to adjust your bass output on your subwoofer to make it sound better with most music. But remember, just keep in mind that depending how you set this up, you'll either have good sounding music or overpowering sounding bass that will make your subwoofer sound like it's overdriven. So just play with it when you get one of these and you install it. That's the best advice I can give you on that. So now that we have this set up, I'm going to go ahead and put my seat back the way it was, and we're going to go on over to the audio control epicenter, and I'm going to show you guys from there how I have everything set up, because I have my camera here that I'm going to be recording some audio stuff for you guys to test out some actual music. And I hope I don't get copy strike, but I'm going to play some music for you guys and show you guys how this system sounds. Alrighty, so when it comes to the audio control epicenter, this is a little bit easier to deal with. To really make sure that you get like the best out of both worlds, leave the white in the center and the sweep in the center. The white is like your bandpass setup, where you want, how wide do you want the frequency that's set here to expand out and basically reach other frequency ranges. And this one here, the sweep, it's your frequency. As to why they call it sweep instead of frequency, I don't know why they do that, but if you put it all the way down, it is at 27 hertz. If you put it all the way up at maximum, it's at 63 hertz. So to tune the epicenter, if you really want to do that, let's say you want to set your frequency from your subwoofer at 30 hertz. That's where you want the bass to hit really hard, right? You want to turn this wideness all the way down. You want to have the sweep, which is your frequency, all the way down as well to 27 hertz, right? What you're going to want to do is connect a multimeter to the outputs of your epicenter. And then over here, sorry about that, you want to set your knob for your epicenter to the middle. Leave it right there. Don't change that. Always leave it there for this setup. And then what you want to do afterwards, on your head unit, you want to put a 60 hertz frequency tone at 0 dB. When you do this, on the multimeter itself, on the display, as you start turning this up, you are going to notice that the number is going to go up on the AC voltage on your multimeter. When it reaches, let's say 2.85, just as an example, and you start turning it up and it goes from 2.85 to like 2.75, 2.65, 2.4, and it starts going lower instead of higher, then you want to go and you back it down to the highest number possible, which will be the 2.85. And if you go lower again, then it starts going back down again to 2.75, 2.65, 2.4. So then you want to put it right back to where you had it at, where it's at its maximum number on the multimeter, which will be 2.85. Now, the 2.85 is just an example, okay? That's all it is. Once you have it there, your 30 hertz frequency is officially set. What you want to do afterwards is set your wideness to how wide you want the epicenter's tone to basically widen up on that frequency. So if you want the 30 hertz to reach to 40 or 60 hertz, and then from 30 down to 27, then leave this right at the center, just like that. And once it's in the center, you're all set. In my case, because I have a sealed enclosure, I have it right in the middle so that I don't have to worry about any weird you know, too low of a frequency going into the subwoofer and damaging the sub, specifically because it's in a sealed enclosure. But that's all you do with the epicenter to set it up if you want to tune it to a specific frequency. Alrighty, so let's talk about the HD600/4 amps and the HD750 amp and how I set the gains. Now, in a little bit, I am going to explain under my computer how I had to set the DSP in order to be able to set my gains on my amplifiers. And it's supposed to be a very simple thing to do, but you can run into some issues after you set up your frequency range on your DSPs, and you may still have to mess around with the gain setting on the amplifier to match it down to your speakers, because your amps can end up having too much power that your speakers can't tolerate, and that was the case for me. Let's talk about power rating and how I was able to determine what these amplifiers can do. I do have a DD1 Plus, which is right here. Here's my DD1 Plus. I've used it a handful of times already, and it's giving me great results. The only bad thing about the tool is that it only detects distortion at 40 Hertz and at 1000 Hertz. So it's like one of those two hit wonder type deal, but it's a good tool overall. That's why you have to use something like the OM-1, which is the output meter, or the VU-DIN if you can get your hands on one, and set them up to match the distortion point with the DD1. On the HD amps, using the DD1, I got a clean, and I mean a real clean, zero distortion, 28 volts with a 1000 Hertz test tone at 0 dB, which at 4 ohms, that is equal to 196 watts RMS per channel via Ohm's law, which JL Audio also uses a very similar formula to help their amp users know how to set their amp gains to match the power of their amps using a multimeter on AC volts, with the same thing at 1000 Hertz frequency test tone at 0 dB. So that means that these amplifiers are giving 46 watts RMS more than these amplifiers are actually rated for. So this is really good if you want to have some good output without having to worry about voltage drop and having to lose power. And this is on car power, not like the way Steve Mead does his testings with these big battery bank machines and all that stuff. This is like normal daily user type deal. So that was pretty good. And because it was too much, I did drop it down, because JL Audio recommends to set the gains on their HD600/4 amps to 24.4, but I decided to use Ohm's law and I set it to 24.49 volts with a 1000 Hertz test tone at 0 dB, which at 4 ohms, that is equal to 150 watts RMS per channel. I had to really drop the voltage down on the HD amps because they were way too powerful for the C7 speakers, man. And I will explain in a bit how I had to drop the gain voltage on each amp to match the real power handling of each C7 speaker after tuning them to their frequency settings, and also setting the time alignment and EQ settings to match my Ford Flex interior acoustic respectively. On the HD750/1 amp, using the same DD1 Plus, I got a clean 41 volts with the 40 Hertz test tone at 0 dB, which at 2 ohms, that is equal to 840 watts RMS via Ohm's law, which again, JL Audio also uses a very similar formula to be able to help their users match the amp gain to what the amp is supposed to do. The easy way, using, you know, a multimeter and a 40 Hertz frequency tone, but in their case, they like to use 50 Hertz at 0 dB. But because the DD1 Plus can only do 40 Hertz or 1000 Hertz, I went with the 40 Hertz test tone at 0 dB to set up the amp gain. And from my testing, that is equal, using Ohm's law, to 90 watts RMS more than its rated power. And these amps really seem to like that 2 ohm load on the monoblock amps, the HD750/1 and the HD1200/1. If you have a 2 ohm subwoofer, you're going to get the best performance out of these amplifiers using that. On the HD600/4 amps, though, I would highly recommend that you stick with 4 ohms. On this HD750 amplifier, JL Audio recommends that you set the gain at 38.7, or in my case, since I decided to go with Ohm's law, you set it up at 38.72 volts with a 50 Hertz test tone. But I used a 40 Hertz test tone at 0 dB, which after setting everything up, it equals 750 watts RMS. at the 2 ohm load. This amp also had a little too much power for the 10W6 V3, so I did have to drop the voltage down to match the 10W6 to the 600 wattish, you know, range with a gain overlap of like plus 5 dB because this SMD DD1 Plus can do overlap to get the subwoofer to basically play loud but with a clean signal. And this allowed me to have the 10W6 play at about 675 watts, give or take, with a 40 hertz test tone at 0 dB without overpowering the subwoofer too much and hurting it. So to accomplish this, I had to set the gain at 36.74 volts with a 40 hertz test tone at 0 dB. Now that I'm done with this here, let's go on to the speakers and tell you a little bit more about that, because that's a lot more complicated and I might be stepping on some shoes here with JL Audio. And I did talk to them about trying to figure out how do they determine their power rating on their speakers. Unfortunately, they told me that their research and development team does not allow them to reveal anything that can cause them to be able to reveal any of their secrets of how they do their system setups or how they determine power rating. So because they don't want to say how, I'm going to go ahead and give you guys my opinion as a DIYer and using the DD1 Plus and what I was actually able to realistically get after having to step my gain settings down on the amplifiers for the C7 speakers on the doors, the 8 pillars, and the D pillars. So let's go ahead and start with the C7 tweeter. All right, so let's talk about the C7 tweeters here. So the C7 tweeters sound really nice. They have a good sound frequency coming out of them. They sound very crispy and clear, but I do have some concerns and I'm going to get into detail about this. So the C7 tweeters are priced at $250 each. Yeah, that's right. It's expensive for each one. And that tweeter is this one right here, man. Look, the power handling is supposed to be 100 watts RMS at 4 ohms continuously at a frequency range of 3000 hertz to 30,000 hertz. The TWK88 DSPs could only go up to 20,000 hertz, which it doesn't really matter because 20,000 hertz is more than enough to get nice clarity out of these speakers. On the amps, I dropped the gain voltage on the amps to 20 volts, which equals 100 watts, you know, RMS at 4 ohms, but even that was way too powerful for these tweeters, man. So I ended up having to set the gain on the amp by ear to where the tweeter didn't sound harsh. And when I set it to where it sounded loud but smooth, I tested the voltage on the amps again using the DD1 Plus at 1000 hertz at 0 dB. And I got a voltage of 14.83 volts with zero distortion, which is equivalent to a realistic power handling of 55 watts RMS at 4 ohms with my frequency that I had set up on the DSP, which I'll show you guys in a little bit. I don't know about you guys, but that's 45 watts less RMS than what JL Audio is claiming that the C7 tweeters can do with the same frequency range they recommended. You can determine for yourself on whether this will be worth it for you, you know, after finding that out. Since, like I said earlier, JL didn't want to reveal how they determine what the power ratings are for each one, whether they use like a pink noise, white noise, a 500 hertz test tone, a 1000 hertz test tone. How do they rate their power handling on their speakers to be that so-called, you know, 100 watts RMS continuously at their frequency range? Because I'm going to show you guys my DSP settings and you're going to see for yourself that it's well within that frequency range and at 24 dB. And I'm not getting 100 watts out of these. I'm getting 55 watts RMS clean, which is still loud. Don't get me wrong. It's still loud, but it's not its rated power loud. So I just want to clear that out. So now let's go into the 3.5 inch driver, which is this one right here. Now the convenience of but the size of the speaker is how it fits. Look how it fits on the A pillar. It looks awesome and it's off axis. And when you put it like this, look, it only sticks out just a tiny bit. If I would have gone with the C5 instead in the three-way, the speaker would be sticking out a lot more and it would be even larger than this. This is a 4-inch diameter from this corner to this corner. It's a 4-inch diameter. With the grill on the C5 4-inch driver, it would reach it to 5 inches, and that's just too much for this thing to handle. This speaker will practically be hitting the dash here, and that's why I went with the C7 line instead, because it meets my installation needs. On the C7 3.5 inch mid-range, which is the C7 350 cm, the speakers are priced at $400 each. Yeah, that's expensive. 3.5 inch driver for $400. So again, it is priced very high. JL Audio claims that the power handling is supposed to be 100 watts RMS at 4 ohms continuously at a frequency range of 300 hertz to 10,000 hertz. For these, I also had to drop the gain on the amp to 20 volts, which also equals 100 watts RMS at 4 ohms. But even that was way too much power for these small 3.5 inch speakers. So I had to also set the gain on the amp for these speakers by ear. And when I got them to sound loud and smooth, I went ahead and I took out the DD1 again and I tested the outputs using the same DD1 plus at 1000 hertz at 0 dB, and I got a voltage of 16.12 volts with zero distortion, which is equivalent to a realistic power handling of 65 watts RMS at 4 ohms, and my frequency range was well within that same output that they're claiming that it can do, which was 500 hertz to 5000 hertz at 24 dB. So that is 35 watts RMS less than what JL Audio is claiming that their C7 3.5 inch mid-range speakers can do with the same frequency range they recommend. So the power rating that they're claiming doesn't match what I was actually getting, and I'm using the DD1 plus. Now I know I'm not using something like an AMM-1 from SMD that can, you know, detect actual RMS power, what music is playing. But if you go with that same JL Audio formula on how to set the amp gains, then this should be equal to that. No, so again, I'm a DIYer and I'm just going by what I did of test results, which is why it took me almost a whole month to put this review together to really narrow down all the issues that might be wrong with it and give you guys my ups and downs. I'm not going to favor JL Audio over any other company, even if I was sponsored by them. And the reason why is because if you guys consider buying these speakers, you guys need to know the truth about them. They sound freaking amazing, but they're not doing their rated power. So let's go over to the C7 6.5 inch driver, which is at the door. Alrighty, so it's kind of sad, but you're not going to be able to see the C7 6.5 inch driver because it's inside of this flex door grill. But you can kind of see the ring around this edge here and then the ring at the top. I finally got to fix the depth issue, and you guys seen that on a previous video. So now these 6.5 inch drivers are listed or priced at $500 each. Yeah, again, that's quite a bit, huh? And the power handling is supposed to be 125 watts RMS at 4 ohms continuously at a frequency range of 50 hertz to 5000 hertz. So on these speakers, I dropped the amp gain voltage down to 22.3, which in my case was 22.36 using Ohm's law, to match the speaker output of 125 watts RMS to the amps. But the same thing happened with these under JL Audio's recommended frequency range, with the door speakers being overdriven as well. So I had to take the time to set the amp gains by ear for these ones as well, to where the speaker sounded loud but smooth at my volume number 20 on my head unit. And when I tested the actual voltage using the DD1 plus with the 1000 hertz test tone at 0 dB, I got a voltage of 18.43 volts with the speaker sounding phenomenal with zero distortion. This is pretty much equivalent to a realistic power handling of 85 watts RMS at 4 ohms for these speakers, and my frequency range is between 70 hertz to 20,000 hertz at 24 dB. That's basically 40 watts RMS less than what JL Audio is claiming that these C7 speakers right here are supposed to be doing or are rated for. So I originally had them set at 80 hertz to 500 hertz as recommended by a JL rep named Lee Dobbs, but it sounded very bad. So when I opened the frequency range up a whole lot wider to where I currently have it, which is at, you know, 70 hertz to 20,000 hertz on the C7 door speakers, that's when things started to sound a lot better and smoother. I'm gonna let you guys, you know, hear the music, how it sounds, how loud it sounds. And again, it does get loud, but it's not 125 watts loud. These are intended for sound quality and not for like PRV loudness. So that's one thing that you have to take into consideration. When it comes to music detail, they sound awesome and they definitely do outperform my C5s. So let me go ahead and take you guys to my computer. We can go over the DSP settings together. I'll show you exactly where I had to set my DSP at to be able to get a full range signal completely coming out of the DSP so you can set your amp gains. But again, like I mentioned before, you may have to drop your amp gains to match your speakers to what they can actually really output. I had to do this with real music in order for me to drop them down and get them to sound to where I want them, where everything sounds good at its maximum volume of number 20 on the head unit. So let's go over there to my computer now so I can talk to you guys about this, because this is a little bit more complex. Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, so we're now at my computer and I'm going to show you guys real quick how you have to have your DSP set up in order to be able to set your gains on your amplifier. It's simple, but yet for me it was a little bit complicated. So let me put this on full screen. Here we go. And I'm going to go under open project and I'm going to go to front zone full range. I'm going to click no because I don't want to change the name that I already have. And here are my settings. So let me explain this real quick. So I have my front left channel, front right channel, which are actually wired up as my front door speaker, my front mid-range, and my front tweeter. And the same for the front right channel, front door, mid-range, tweeter. And then here for the rear doors, obviously it's your rear left door and rear right door. If you look at this chain, it goes all the way to the bottom here where it says 1 and 2, and there's a little chain in the middle. The chain in the middle is for your equalizer. It's so that when you go to your EQ settings under the tune page, which is next, you have everything identical for each speaker. However, if you really wanted to do something crazy, you can actually remove the EQ setting and set these actually completely different to each other. But because I have a matching left and right tweeter, left and right mid-range, and left and right door speaker, while I wanted the frequencies to sound the same for each driver, according, you know, to the way I want to have this set up, everything on the DRC knob setup has to remain the same. Your DRC knob will be disabled as you're using the tune software, so you're going to have to depend on these levels right here where the volume controls at and have these all the way up. On your outputs, you can custom name each section, so I have these named accordingly. You can do a screenshot of that if you want. I'm going to turn this on just for fun. So what you want to do here is you want to make sure that you go to your inputs on the upper left hand corner, click on that, and set your input settings on your TWK to the level here, whether it's 4 volts, 5.6, or 7.1, until you see the least amount of distortion going into the signal. Because on my radio, though, my cleanest signal is volume number 21. I have mine at 20 because I felt more comfortable with that. And my outputs coming out of my LC7 are also set good at 4 volts pretty much across, except for the second channel, which is the rear. So in my case, because I was still getting a distorted signal at 1000 hertz at 0 dB, I had to set these to 7.1 to reduce that and also reduce this weird excessive hissing that I was getting out of the amplifiers and the DRC knob when I had it all the way up. If I turn the DRC knob down to like 3/4 volume, the hissing will go away. So I think that when it comes to the DRC knob, the Tweak 88 wants you to depend fully on the DRC knob for your volume output as a master permanent volume and leave your radio at volume 20 permanently, which I can't do that because of my navigation and all kinds of other stuff, including chimes that go off and lowers the volume of the radio to be able to make adjustments. So make sure that you set your inputs accordingly till you have the least amount of red mark on there. If you have a slither of red, it's not a big deal. Now that you see how all of this is set up, let's go on over to the tune side, because this is the fun part. Now here on the tune side, under equalizer, you want to leave all of this at zero. Don't touch anything here. You want to focus under the crossover, so you are going to have to make some changes here once you set your stuff up. Now for this setup, I went with a 4-way component type set under the program, and then I customized everything by removing everything the way JL Audio had it prefixed and making my own stuff. So this allowed me to set all of these to full range. So off doesn't mean that you're not getting a signal coming out of it. Off just means you're getting a full range signal coming across this crossover and going into the output level trim of your DSP. Now this is all you need to do to be able to set your gains on your amplifiers. However, if you come up across distortion on your speakers and they don't sound that good even with your gain at zero, then you're going to have to lower the dB on here, and the highest it goes is 0 dB. So you'll have to start lowering it down until you no longer hear that distortion coming out or see the distortion coming out of your DD1 plus. Right here, even though on my thing I still had like a slither of red out of the three little icons. It was one little icon here and a little tiny slither. When I had this set up, I couldn't hear the distortion anymore coming out of the amplifiers. So then I was able to amplify this output signal to my amps to go to my speakers. So this is exactly how I had mine set up. It may be a little bit different for you, but this is all you have to do. So again, your crossovers here, everything off so that you can have a full range signal. Then on your radio, you'll put your 1000 hertz frequency or your 40 hertz frequency and you set your gains and pretty much forget it if you know you're not going to be messing around with anything else. But trust me, you might end up coming up across that same problem and you're going to have to change things. Let's go ahead and go over to Open Project. I'm going to show you guys my front settings now. Here we go. This is my actual programming that I have on my Tweak 88 for my front eight pillars, my front doors, and my rear doors. So if you can see right here, again, the input here is set at 7.1 and I like it there. It's fine where it's at. I have, again, everything set exactly the same. The only thing I changed here was the DRC setup. Now the Tweak 88 cannot detect the DRC 200 or the DRC 205. It can detect either. So it doesn't matter which one you use, it's gonna come out the same. Right here, I have it set under volume and fader control. So master volume controls all the speakers, which is a little knob in the middle, and you cannot unclick these. No matter what you do, you can't unclick either one of these at all. Period. You can't unclick them. It's just a permanent thing. What you can change are the fader control, which is the left knob side. When you turn the knob all the way to the left, you get control of your front doors. And when you turn it to the right, you get control of your rear doors. Now, if I wanted to, I can put these front doors back here on this side here, like whatever. And now I would have the mid-range speaker separate and the rear and front door separate. But because I like the fader control the way it is, I have it set like this. And again, everything stayed exactly the same how you see it here, the front left tweeter, front right tweeter, etc. I'm gonna turn this on just for fun. And now we're gonna go over to the tune. Now, feel free right here to go ahead and pause the screen or pause the video and take a screenshot. Okay, so this is the most important part here, the crossover settings here. Now I have the settings at 5,000 hertz to 20,000 hertz for the tweeters. For the mid-range, which are these two right here, left and right, I have it at 500 hertz to 5,000 hertz at 24 dB. The speakers for the doors, front and rear, are set at 70 hertz to get some good mid-bass coming out of them instead of 80 hertz. And I have these set at 24 dB, and the crossover for the high frequency is completely off. So these are set from 70 hertz to full range, and they sound awesome like that. And you guys are about to hear how they sound. Hopefully it sounds good through the microphone. You might hear some distortion, but in real life, you don't hear any of that. Now here is where the complicated part comes up. This is where I was actually getting distortion with my output trim level set at 0 dB like JL Audio stated. So in order to not get distortion coming out of that 1000 hertz frequency, this is how I had to set everything up. I had to put these at minus 4.5 dB for the tweeters, minus 5 dB for the mid-range, and minus 7 dB for the mid-bass speakers on the doors. This really helps smooth out that harsh frequency sounding thing from the 1000 hertz. And then from here, I set my gains on the amplifiers accordingly from what you have already heard. So if you want, again, take a screenshot of this, and I'm going to share my EQ settings right now. EQs 1 and 2 are for the tweeters. These are flat. These don't matter. I'm going to switch it over to EQ 3 and 4 right now. So this little highlighted area is now set to the mid-range frequencies. Please take a look at the EQ settings that I have set up right here where I'm turning the little cursor thing, and pause the video and take a screenshot so you can see how this is set up, so you can try this out on your speakers and see how that sounds to you. Now I'm going to go ahead and switch on over to channels 5 and 6 for the front doors and channel 7 and 8 for the rear doors. I'm going to click on the front doors EQ settings. So this is now highlighted. Please take a look again at these frequency ranges that I have here, and you may pause the screen and take a screenshot so you can record this for your records if you want to try this out. Now I'm going to go over to EQ 7 and 8, which is the rear doors. Now the reason I have these set up the way they are, technically the door is considered an enclosure for the mid-range speakers or the mid-bass speakers. So you are welcome to pause the video right now, take your screenshot off your phone, and just go ahead and write down this information, or just keep a look, you know, an eye out for this information here and try it out on your setup and see how it works. Okay, so here's the rear side, which is the second TWK88, and right now it's currently set to passenger side because that's where I left it at. And this is how it's set up. It looks a little bit more more cleaner, right? So you have your rear tweeters left and right, rear mid-range left and right, and your subwoofer line, right? And on the DRC, it is set up as volume plus subwoofer because that's all I need it for. Now, if I was only using one DRC 205 knob, then it would be exactly the same and I would just have my other channels there set up and just a, you know, subwoofer on one side or whatever. But this is how it's set up. So let's go ahead and go on over to the tuning because I feel like that's very important. Again, EQ setting is the same and the mid-range is the same as the front eight pillars. That has not changed. So what you want to look at is right here in the bottom on the crossovers. Same deal here, how it is in the front eight pillars, but the subwoofer is set at 20 hertz to 100 hertz as the highest. And if you go under EQ 5 and 6, which is my subwoofer, please feel free to pause the video right now so that you can do a screenshot of this. I have the frequency changed to 20 hertz here and a 6 dB overlap and a 70 hertz frequency here with 0 dB overlap, but a Q of 4.91, which really does help the frequencies here. And you can see it's sliding a bit up. Even though I have this set at 20, it's still picking up other frequencies around it before it reaches 70. So from 20 hertz all the way to 70 hertz is picking up these frequencies here that you see. So this is how I have mine set up. Now, if you go to the output trims, these are exactly identical to the tweeters in the mid-range. And what's different is the subwoofer. The subwoofer is at minus 2 dB. I would highly suggest that you do not go any higher than minus 2 dB. Keep it at either minus 2 dB or minus 3 dB if you're going to go with the same exact setup using the HD amplifiers. But if you're using the VXI amplifiers, then this is going to be completely different for you. But these are my settings here. This is it, guys. So now that you guys already seen all of this, let's go ahead and go on over to a parking area and give you guys some sound tests. Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm going to be giving you guys a quick demo of my audio system. This is with my volume at maximum number 20. So you guys can see there, number 20. And so you guys know that I'm not in any way cheating. Here are my settings. Everything is at flat. The epicenter knob down here is off. If I turn it up higher, it gets brighter. You see that? So it's all the way off because the epicenter is not needed for hip hop style music. So what I'm going to be playing for you guys right now, again at volume number 20, is going to be a song by Compton Menace. The song is called All I Know, and I'm not sure what album it's on. All I know is that Decaf had it on one of his USB thumb drive stuff, and I have it here with me now. So I'm going to go ahead and step out of my car, give you guys a quick minute and a half or so of a demo, and then we'll go for the next songs because this is the only thing that has like legit voicing. So let's go with that. Any distortion you hear coming out from the bass, it's because the microphone just can't handle it.
Feeling good, smoking up some killer. Got my pockets full of swimming, nigga. I'm the realest nigga. I know. This shit is crazy. Know all them haters, they hate it. Just me, ain't I'm born and bombing. I do that shit on the daily. No politic and for paper. My patience that came in handy. Can't see 30s for real. For niggas don't understand. I got lost in the hood, just trying to find me a way. From quarterback in the bricks, trying to make me a play. Them niggas act like they love you, but steady, stay in your way. While I'm contemplating for friendships and touching over them pigs. But hey, I know they love it, I'm talking about them bitches. I'm smoking and drinking with me, I'm talking about when I'm tipping. That's when taking trips out of town. I had that bitch reminiscing. I dropped that top on the caddy, I'm talking about when I'm pimps.
Alrighty, So I turned down the music because there's a cop right over there and I don't want to get in trouble. But that is how it sounds like with voices and music in general. So hopefully I don't get a copy strike on this. So let me go ahead and turn this down. Now what I would like to do for you guys is go ahead and give you guys a demo of an instrumental song. So I'm going to play a song from Lee Ritenour. I want you guys to kind of try to focus on some of the drumming that comes out of the audio. So let me go ahead and switch on over to that and then we'll go from there. Alrighty, so here goes the song from Lee Ritenour. It's called LA Underground. And I'm gonna go ahead and play it for you. And again, it's at volume number 20. You're looking at it right now. Try to see if you can focus on the detail of the drumming. I know that you're not gonna really get a good idea out of it because again, I'm using a Rode VideoMic Pro and you're not really going to get a really direct sound coming out of this versus an in-person listening session. But here we go. Down because I'm making sure that the cops are not still over there, man. This is the only time I can actually come here and try to give you guys a decent demo. But let me go ahead and close these doors because what I wanted to do was to play a song for you guys using the Epicenter so you can hear the difference of what the Epicenter sounds like, engage and disengage. So let me go ahead and get in here and hopefully we can get into that right now. Okay, so the song I'm gonna play for you guys right now is called Rotten Apple by Alice in Chains. Hopefully, again, I don't get copy strike. This is only for musical demonstration purposes only on the audio system. So I'm gonna play the clip for about a minute and 10 seconds or so without the Epicenter engage and then with the Epicenter engage. Hopefully you guys can hear the difference.
Thank you.
Okay, let me play it for you guys again. This time with the epicenter engaged right at the center. You don't want to turn it up any louder than that to get the accurate bass response from the epicenter. Here we go again. So I had to stop it there because, you know, copyright stuff. But anyways, you can kind of hear the audio control epicenter doing its job, but there are some parts where the epicenter hesitated a little bit to kind of determine what frequency it should lower itself to in order to match that higher frequency. And that's the thing about the epicenter. You're either going to have really good results or the song is going to sound really bad. All right, so here comes my official input on this. So what do I think about the audio system? In all honesty, the audio system sounds nice. This is way better than anything Ford could have ever put together specifically for the Flex. And I do like how the audio system, you can hear it all around in the inside of the car based on how I have everything adjusted. So my kids can listen to it, my wife can listen to it, I can listen to it. I have different presets. Another thing that's really important is time alignment. Make sure you set up your time alignment for your driver's side, passenger side in the front, and the center of your second row seating to make sure that you have at least three different settings for your time alignment. And it will change the way the sound comes out of the speakers because of the latency that they provide. So with that said, would I recommend an audio system like this for you? In all honesty, I would only recommend it to you if you can afford it. Another reason I would recommend it is if it meets your needs like it did with mine, especially on the sizing of the speakers. Third is if you really care about sound quality and do not care about how loud the system can get. That's a key point here when it comes to these speakers, because like I mentioned earlier, these speakers are intended for sound quality and not for like PRV hair trick type sound, you know. So as long as you keep that in mind, I would recommend it for you. Reasons I wouldn't recommend it for you is, number one, pricing. This system without any labor work, because I did all the labor work, was about $14,000+ for the entire setup. And I'm including everything from the speaker cabling, the power wiring, the speakers itself, the amplifiers, the plastic that I needed for the ABS amp racks, everything pretty much. The stealth box, the 10W6 V3, and that's about it, because I'm not including the TVs or the Roku in this pricing. However, the sound quality is really good and I'm going to stick to my guns on that. But the power rating is really low for what JL Audio is basically advertising. Again, I'm just a DIY guy, so I could be wrong on how I counted everything, considering the different kinds of frequencies, not just 1000 Hertz, goes into the audio system. So I could be wrong, maybe they are doing their power or not, but the fact that I had to really adjust the amp gains down, that was pretty surprising for me. So another reason I wouldn't recommend the audio system to you is, besides pricing, is installation.
For example, you have to install everything separately. There are no crossovers included. You have to run the system actively, which means that it's going to cost you more to have to run a DSP with your audio system, and you have to have some knowledge on setting up your DSP, which I kind of struggled with that a little bit and had to take a bunch of JL Audio seminar classes online. Some people did it through Facebook, some people did it through, I think, Instagram. I did it direct through them, but you know, again, you really have to have some knowledge on this to be able to set your gains right, and also your frequency ranges, and learning a lot about time alignment, which is really important. That's pretty much the only things I wouldn't recommend. And of course, like I mentioned earlier, the power output. If I can go back in time, I would literally go with the VX800/8i for my front speakers and the rear doors. And I would do a VX1005/i for my D-pillar speakers and the subwoofer, because that amp has plenty of power to run the 10W6V3 at its 600 watts. And if you add an overlap gain to it, with a tiny bit of distortion, you can probably get it to the 675 watts that I'm running the sub at a comfortable listening volume where the sub doesn't sound like it's being overdriven. I do plan on fixing my 2002 Buick Park Avenue. If I can get that 2002 Buick Park Avenue running, my intentions are to put some C5s that I already bought for this vehicle into the car. Then, and only then, would I consider removing the HD amps entirely out of this Ford Flex and going with the VX iLine to simplify my system on this vehicle, and throwing in one of the two TWKs into the Park Avenue with the HD amps, and probably sell the rest of the gear on eBay that I don't need. So other than that, that's pretty much it for my review. I hope you enjoyed it. It took me a month to put this together because I was trying to get legitimate information for you guys before I would post up some stuff that made sound like nonsense. I did this from the heart, and I hope you guys appreciate it and you value the input that I have. Again, I'm a DIY guy. I did not get sponsored. Everything that I put together in the system you guys seen on YouTube, I put a lot of work into it, a lot of labor hours, and I also put a lot of money into this. So it sounds really good, and I know it's for my own benefit, but I figured I would share my input with you guys to let you guys know whether it's worth it or not. So after you listen to those clips already, you can determine for yourself somewhat whether this will be a fit for you. So that's it for this video, guys. I'd like to thank you guys for sticking around for the long period of time that I had this video running, and I'll see you guys on the next video, because I got a company to collab with me for some LED fog lights, and I'm going to be reviewing them for them. And there's a special thing for you guys at the end of that video, so I can't wait to get started on working on it so we can see what it's all about and how it benefits you guys. So have a good one, guys. Peace for now.